We're going to calculate the adiabatic reactor temperature for reversible liquid phase reactions. So the idea is we have some type reactor. Now it turns out because we're calculating the adiabatic temperature, it doesn't matter whether this is a plug flow reactor or a continuous stirred tank reactor, or even a closed system batch reactor. In this case, we're assuming we're feeding in pure A at 300 Kelvin. We have some flow rate. What that is doesn't matter for this. Adiabatic means Q is zero. And we're interested in the equilibrium mixture leaving. So we're going to run it to equilibrium, and we want to know what's the final temperature leaving the reactor. Now we're going to make some assumptions. We could certainly relax these in more complicated calculation, but to demonstrate the idea, we're going to assume ideal solution. And what that means is then we can write down the equilibrium constant in terms of mole fractions or concentration. So concentration of B at equilibrium, concentration of A at equilibrium, because the reaction is just A goes to B. Since we're interested in conversion, we can write this equilibrium constant in terms of conversion. The concentration of A would be our initial concentration that we're feeding in times 1 minus our equilibrium conversion. We convert 40%, 60% remains. The concentration of B, since we only feed A to the reactor, is what fraction of A is converted, since the stoichiometry is 1:1. So we're going to use this to relate fractional conversion to equilibrium constant. We're given the equilibrium constant at one temperature, 298 Kelvin, and we're given the heat of reaction so we can calculate the equilibrium constant at other temperatures. So what we're going to do is use the Van 't Hoff equation. And this relates equilibrium constant at one temperature to equilibrium constant at another temperature. So the log K2 is at some temperature that we don't know yet. K1 will be our initial, where we have information, 298 Kelvin. This is related to the heat of reaction divided by the gas constant, and then 1 over temperature 2. 1 over temperature 1, where, of course, temperature must be absolute temperature. So I'm going to substitute the values we know into this equation. So I've substituted, and what I want to solve for, actually, is K2. So I'm going to take exponent of both sides, because then I can solve this for the extent of reaction and calculate that for different values of K, which corresponds, of course, to different temperatures. Let me first solve for K2 as a function of temperature. Keep in mind, this equation for K, the CA0 cancels. If I solve this for equilibrium extent of reaction in terms of the equilibrium constant, it just becomes this. Where, remember, the equilibrium constant is a function of temperature, as indicated here. So this is K at any temperature, written it for temperature T2. The other thing we need, of course, to finish solving this problem is the adiabatic reactor energy balance. And so let me write that down. The energy balance, we have molar flow rate coming into reactor. We have heat capacity of reactant. We want to solve at equilibrium conditions, feed temperature. So this is the energy, if you like, to heat up the feed to the final temperature. Since the heat capacities of A and B are the same, then I can just write everything in terms of heat capacity of A. And the reason, of course, the temperature increases is I have a heat reaction, and then some fraction of that material A flowing in is converted. This term here is moles of A react per time. Of course, FA0 is going to cancel out of this equation, and I'm going to end up with the equation for the equilibrium conversion in terms of the heat capacity of A, equilibrium temperature, T0 is my feed temperature, and then minus the heat of reaction. So the equilibrium conversion is just linear in temperature. I can substitute in the numbers. Okay, so now I'm about finished. I have this relationship here. So this is one equation. My second equation is this one, relating the equilibrium conversion to the equilibrium constant. And then I'm going to substitute this equilibrium constant into here. So it's a function of temperature also. We look at what these equations look like. This is an exothermic reaction. As I raise the temperature, the equilibrium conversion goes down. At very low temperatures, it'd be close to one, and then it decreases as I raise the temperature. That's what equation number two is going to show. Equation number one is just a straight line, the energy balance. So this is energy balance. And this is the equilibrium relationship. This is the adiabatic equilibrium conversion. So here's the equilibrium conversion. Here is the adiabatic temperature. If I solve these equations, I won't go through the details here. Equilibrium adiabatic temperature 460K. This corresponds to an equilibrium conversion of 40%. And so that's just from solving the equations simultaneously. Lots of ways you could do it. Could certainly also just plot them out in Excel and read off the value graphically. As reaction proceeds and temperature increases, of course, our equilibrium conversion decreases. If we run long enough to get the equilibrium, this is what temperature we'd reach and what equilibrium conversion we would reach.